A very good morning to one and all present here. So Leadership Committee welcomes you all to the fourth session of Excel Leadership Talk and wishes you a very happy new year. We request you all to keep your cell phones on silent or switched off mode. Thank you. Leadership Committee takes this opportunity to thank our esteemed guests of honor for being part of the XLRI Leadership Series. I would now request Ms. Shweta to welcome our guest of honor for today. I would now invite Rajesh Ranjan to deliver the welcome address.
A very good morning to one hour present here. Mr. Nadeem Kazim is a postgraduate in personal management and industrial relations from Xavier Institute of Social Services. He started his career with BIL in 1986 in the space of personal and industrial relations. He moved to Tata Steel in 1991 and served them for 18 years in various capacities. He played a lead role in IR, HR, and L&D assignment. He played a pivotal role in designing and introducing innovative HR practices for Tata Steel. He joined Exide Industries Limited as Executive Vice President in January 2009. He was elevated as whole-time director in the board of Exide and designated as Director HR and Personal, effective from May 2011. He is also the board of director of the subsidiary companies of Exide Industries, that is Chloride Metals Limited, Chloride Alloys India Limited, and Chloride Power System and Solutions Limited. In the current assignment, he spearheads corporate HR and strategic IR initiatives for the company. Besides human resource function, he is a director in charge for the two subsidiary companies with CEOs reporting to him. He has introduced many pioneering people and HR practices in the company. Mr. Nadeem Kazim is a visiting faculty to various institutes in India. He has delivered several talks in the national and regional level seminars and conferences. He has authored several articles in professional journals. He is also a life member of several professional bodies. He is currently the chairman of the IR subcommittee for Eastern India at CII. Mr. Nadeem Kazim has a dynamic profile developed over 26 years, first in the space of IR and human resources, and subsequently as a senior corporate business leader. I now request all of you to please welcome him to the stage so that he can address all of you and give us some good knowledge and insights into the current industry structure and the learnings that he has gathered over these years. So.
A very good morning to all of you. And at the outset, I wish to thank XLRI and Pradeep Subramaniam, who met me in the NHRD conference a couple of months back. And at that point in time, he said that, why don't you come and address our students? It's always a passion for me to go back to youngsters and talk to them. In fact, if I recollect my 3 days, last 3 days, I was addressing students in BIT Mishra day before yesterday, also at IIM Ranchi. Yesterday I was the exercises addressing them, today I am with XLRI. So I don't know what I am doing, why my company is paying me salary, I don't know. But then I think as a fraternity, it is very important to give back to the future leaders what we have learned. And something I wish to talk to all of you today is not theories, but I think that's something which the professor in any case is going to teach you. What I will kind of try and illustrate is the experiences. I think that's more important because good or bad, I think that's what we all carry beyond a point in time. Subject like leadership, I personally believe, you know, with whatever wisdom I have over the last 26, 27 years in the industry, is one subject which, to my mind, it cannot be taught. Leadership is something which, at best, can be introspective. So, that's the way I think leadership happens. There's a lot of debate whether leadership is a born talent or it is something which can be developed. There are views around. But I strongly believe that each of our behaviors are actually learned behavior, and therefore it can be unlearned. So behaviors of ours or the leadership strength which we have is not genetic, but I think one can always develop it. To some, I think some competency comes very naturally, and to some those competency doesn't come naturally, and therefore a person has to put in that much more hard work to get into that competency. Even before I come to the formal presentation, depending on again the kind of profession we take, is it an HR batch here or it's an MBA marketing? Everybody's the general batch. So fine. So depending on which stream we have taken a specialization for, I think there are competency to my mind which are very core. And absence of that actually becomes very fatal for our growth and success. I think that is very important. And take an example, if you look at people from marketing background, to my mind, people, you know, when you ask why you are in marketing, they say, I like to meet people, I can communicate well, I love to travel, all kind of general view we keep getting in the interviews and otherwise. But to my mind, there is something which is marketing has to have different than the other function, and so it would be from HR. And I just try and narrate you an example from my own life. And that is where I say, to become a good marketing guy, a good sales guy, you need not necessarily have a degree or diploma from XLRI or any other big school. And it's a skill set which again comes naturally to some, and again doesn't come naturally to some. I was here in Jamshedpur at that point in time, some 10-15 years back. You know, there was a television which was called Sony Vega television, which was introduced, and 29 inches, I think some 15 years back, or if not more, was rated as one of the best television in the world with the screen-tone technology and all that. Now, I have gone through all literatures of it, and when I was trying to replace my television, I had done enough research and thought this is a television I must buy. And I left my home with my wife, pre-decided that this is a television I want to buy. Typical Indian mindset, instead of going to a Sony showroom, we went to a multi-brand showroom just to see what other televisions are there, you know. This is the mindset of Indians. So we went. And I still remember very clearly, I asked the sales guy that, look, I want to buy a Sony Vega TV. The moment I said this, he made a very long face. Sony Vega? Theek hai, if you want, I will show you. But sir, there are much better television than that in the market. So I said, what are that television? So he said, LG, look at it. So he showed me the LG television at the same price point, which was PIP in those days, picture in picture. It had a good woofer sound and much more features as compared to Sony at a comparable level. And he says, why the hell you should consider Sony Vega? This is a television you should... So I was trying to argue with him. I said, look, but Trinitron gives you the best quality picture. And he told me, he said, when you are watching a television, it's not only what you are seeing, but you also hear. Look, this woofer sound, this Sony Vega will never produce you this. I think 10 minutes, not more than that, or 7 minutes at the max, he made a dent on my mind to rethink whether I have come with the right decision to buy a Sony Vega television. So I left home chanting Sony Vega, Sony Vega. When I was returning home, I was actually coming with an LG television. This guy was not an MBA. And what I realized is, this is the skills which would be required for anybody who is getting into the marketing or sales space, if this brings some sense to all of you. Because something which I keep saying, because I'm in a B school and I keep talking about it, a lot of B school today, XLI would be a different, but a lot of B school today focuses on imparting knowledge. So maybe Philip Kotler book on marketing may still be taught, I don't know. But then how do I sell? Am I acquiring skill sets which will enable me to sell the product? Am I doing that as a skill building exercise already in the B school? The issue would be, and I think the competency therefore for marketing, which to my mind is very critical, is the ability to influence the mind of the customer. So if in institute you are not able to influence your ideas to your colleagues, be it in HR also you have to influence union people with your ideas. So do you have that innate in you somewhere or not? If not, I think if it is come naturally to you, you are blessed. If it is not coming naturally to you, possibly you have to work hard. So somewhere the skills development becomes a very, very important thing beyond acquiring knowledge. Because the moment you walk into any corporate, they will expect you to give results. It's not the percentile of marks alone which will give you a career, but the skill sets is what is going to give you a career. And leadership is all about that, that are we acquiring the right kind of skill sets beyond the knowledge which will enable me to, you know, deliver higher than the expectation, because the world is ruthless. That's the reality on the ground. And something I talk about it very passionately is, and I want to repeat it here, that academic excellence does not guarantee you a successful career. For the sake of reputation, academics excellence doesn't reward you with a successful career. These two are different things. And I think I'm not undermining academic excellence. If you are scoring good marks, please keep doing, because that's a definite advantage to you. But I think when you're looking leadership, career, success, I think it's a different cup of tea at some point in time. So with these few opening remarks, let me get into the presentation. Maybe I'll be sharing more off and on with experience. And anywhere during the talk you want to interfere, interject, ask any question, please do so. Need not wait till the end, because possibly you would also lose the thought process. You know, change, as we say, is always a constant. When the economy opened up, we saw a lot of fierce competition happening, irrespective of the sectors in which the industry was in. And some of the picture which I will show you was clicked by my camera only few years back, some 5-6 years back, when I landed in Bombay airport. And these are the pictures which I have clicked. And see what it says, you know. When the competition came, Jet came with the ad saying, "We have changed." On this ad on top, Kingfisher put up ad saying that we have made them change. Because they were beating them on that segment of market with their superior product. Then you had Go Airways saying, "We have not changed, we are still the smartest way to fly." All coming one above the other. And there was still another ad saying, "We will never change." I'm still talking about it, because that point in time, somewhere, Lalu Prasad was trying to prove that the second AC fare would be cheaper than the air fare, and so we will never change. And the last was something, you know, the cost came, where please the voting can crash. So I think that's the way the competition goes into explaining things. And so now, when we're talking about leadership, let's look at what is happening in the environment. I think that's also very, very important. So, what is happening in the environment? Today what is happening is, you are competing with the best. No longer India as a country is competing with the second best or third best or fourth best. Irrespective of the product or services you are manufacturing, you are facing a global competition. So you have to be top three, otherwise you don't exist. The second thing which is happening is, globalization is pushing industry for cost competitiveness and quality. So today, if you look at any organization, the cost and quality is becoming a huge thrust area, because if your product is very good, but cost-wise you are up, you don't have a chance. Or you have a very low cost, but the quality is not good, again no customer is going to buy. So cost and quality is becoming a thrust area, because today what is happening, actually when in the market scenario, today the customers are deciding what price they will pay for a product. So what industry can do addresses these two things, beyond innovation, which I will come slightly later. So today what is happening is organizations' designs and strategies are now being determined by the customers. Today, it is not the organization which are deciding what kind of option design and strategies I will have. Today the customers are kind of deciding this. And to give you an example, you know, if I take example of Exide Industries, we are sitting at 80% market share for batteries at the OEM level. And be it Volkswagen or Mercedes or Skoda or Toyota or Honda or whatever you call them, each one of them come with a very stringent design. Each one of them come with a very high quality parameters to be done. And they tell us that this is how your quality has to work. If you're not implementing these standards, we are actually not buying with you. And do you have these qualifications of people? Does your structure support what you are promising to me? So if I am signing an MOU, say with Volkswagen, they are looking at, does my structure support to meet the specification which I am signing with the OEM suppliers? So that is the level at which things are moving. So no more I can decide that, okay, I can recruit somebody, diploma holder also, who can clear the product for application of Volkswagen car. The answer is no. Organizations are becoming more known for their competencies and capability rather than their product. I think this is becoming very key. I think this is a very, very fundamental point. See, earlier organizations were known for the product they used to make. Now, if you look at it, the shelf life of the product itself has gone for a six. You know, there was a time in India where Fiat Ambassador or Herald has ruled this country for 40, 50 years. And last Sunday, if my memory takes me right, the auto car show was showing that 2014, the SUV alone, there are 14 SUV getting launched in this year. So that is the kind of change which is happening in the space of product. And even if you introduce a product, shelf life just goes away. And therefore the competency and capability of the people to completely reinvent themselves and the products and services becomes the key to the organization. Otherwise, we have seen players who have gone up and have perished very fast. Both the shelf life of products and services and also the shelf life of organization today is reducing at a dramatic speed. So therefore, people are becoming the real investment in any organization. So if you look at it, and if I have to say what is the key differentiator in any organization, I think end of the day it is people, nothing else. So some of you who are in the HR space sitting in this room or even in the line space, I think your role, to my mind, is how do you create the best talent in the organization which is contemporary and which can compete in the competitive environment. I think that's becoming the key challenge today for all organizations. Now, on market economy establishment, if you look at it, again, cost of labor as a percentage of total cost is narrowing down. People are looking at 5%, 6% cost basis. If you look at number of employees needed for product and services, it's steadily declining, largely because of the technology and also because of the multi-skilling which is coming to the organization. More to do, less, you know, that's how things are moving. If you look at organization today, it's getting structured more around teams and processes rather than individual and bureaucratic organization which used to be earlier with so many layers. Today, I think organizations are, while they may have grades, 10, 12 in some organization, but work level, if you look at it, it's not more than 5 work level. So it's more around team and more around processes. That's how the organizations are also getting restructured. And total revision cost of compensation, there's an increasing need to make it more flexible so that, you know, it can be aligned with the product cost and the performance of the company. So no longer today, you know, we can look at company after company that whatever increment which was given last year or bonus which was given last year, the next year will be delta plus of that. May or may not happen depending on how the company has performed. So your entire compensation package has to be designed in a way both for the unionized category of people and for the marginal strata, whereby it becomes more variable in nature. To be competitive, what we need to do then, find simpler and more customer-friendly ways to deliver services and product. I think it's very important. And that's the reason a lot of companies today are investing into their logistics management. The cost of logistics itself is a huge subject, and supply chain management has come to a center stage in all the organizations because of the large distribution channel network we have in the country. Redesign and re-engineer to increase flexibility and efficiency of employees, and there's a continuous process which is happening. And develop people to key competency as to survive in the new environment. I think something which I have mentioned a while ago, I think this is something which is happening. Why we are talking about it is developing people with key competitive edge is, you know, I'll just give you one example which has happened very recently. I was traveling abroad with the union president, who is the All India president of some union. I would not give the name for obvious reason. And we were traveling to Europe and we were taking KLM Airlines, and this guy was fasting on that. It was a Tuesday. And so we were traveling together and he said, "Nadeem sir, main to aaj fast hai, can I get fruits?" So I said, "Let me check." So there was an air hostess who was coming. KLM is supposed to be a very good airline. So I asked for the food for the gentleman, and the air hostess said, "Have you asked for the special meal?" And he said, "No." And she said, "Sorry." Matter ended at that. And then, you know, my dinner was served and this guy, nothing was served. So how do I eat when my union president is not eating? So I was in dilemma whether I can eat or not eat. What do I do with this? Another air hostess who was coming, and you know, I just asked her, "Okay, this is a scenario, can you help?" She said, "Let me see." She didn't say sorry. And after that 10-15 minutes passed by, I had still not started eating. So I thought, let me also fast along with the gentleman, because working together is very important in times of traveling. To my surprise, after 15 minutes, the second air hostess on a plate came with apple and orange and something, and banana if I remember correctly, and served him. The point I am trying to drive home is that both the air hostesses were given similar values, similar training, similar kind of customer orientation. But one person is making the difference, not the other. And I think this kind of differentiation is what we need to create more in the organization. I think that is the point I'm trying to drive home. So leadership is not about leadership at your level, but the leadership is actually at where it's matter to the end customer touch point, because that is what gives business to the organization. And then this gentleman said, no, this airline is very good. And next time also travel here. So till it was served, half an hour he was actually cursing this airline. I think this is a very important point. You know, in today's time, and I want to elaborate the subject, unless each one of us doesn't have something very distinctly different in us, our ability to grow in an organization and also to run the full marathon race would become a question mark. Because organization will start respecting you and putting you on a fast track only when they find that yes, this person has a something distinctive whereby it adds greater value to my organization. So it's not about doing something good, but it's about doing things differently and making a different niche in the organization altogether. And for doing this, I think it's very important that we all have to understand ourselves better and see what value we can bring on the table. So this is assuming a lot of importance in today's time, largely because, as I said, the shelf life of the products have reduced dramatically. So it's not a good olden days that you develop a product and it's going to give you a top line, a bottom line goal for the next 20 years. No more the scenario. And therefore, organizations are looking at capability which are distinct in you. So therefore, people are becoming key investment. Each person must add measurable value to the organization. You know, here the point I wanted to drive home is, some of you would have heard, some of you would have will experience. You know, when we are looking at adding measurable value to the organization, let me give you two thought processes. One is the misnomer normally people have that I have worked in an organization for 10 years and therefore I am sitting with the 10 years of experience and I am adding greater value to the organization than a person who is working in this organization for the last 3 years or 4 years. That's the typical misnomer people have, and people demand more CTCs and better position simply because they are putting more years of service and they have more experience to them. Now I look experience from two perspectives. May not be written any book, but that's my learning on the after working in corporate for so long. One set of people in organizations are who has worked 10 years and would have 7 or 8 years of varied experience. The other set of people, which I find more in organization, are they who have put in 1 year of service but have repeated for 10 years. So 1 year experience repeated for 10 years, and the other who have actually had 7-8 years of experience. Typically what happens is people don't add value to themselves. People have passed out from XLRI or IIMs or whatever institute or engineering college, and then they think that this qualification will take me throughout my marathon of 35 or 40 years of service, because I have graduated from a institute and not necessarily whether I have added sufficient value into myself or not. And they try and run their career as a 100 meter race. Whereas, to my mind, a career is about running a marathon. And therefore, you know, while all youngsters are sitting here, I need to say one thing. If you run a 100 meter race, you know, you start running fast from beginning and you get burned out very fast. Today in corporate world, we see a lot of people starting off like this, at the age of 40, 45, quite a large number of them say we are consultant. They use the word consultant, but actually organizations have not wanted them beyond that, because they have been overpaid and they are not adding a value to the proportion of what they are paid. So organizations start writing them off because they have looked at careers running a 100 meter race. Whereas, to my mind, career actually is running a marathon, which would mean that you have to run the full race. And for running the full race, the skill sets required is slightly different. As we have seen in the marathon, the guy doesn't start running fast from the beginning. I think if you have to run the full race of a career, you need to add value to yourself at least for the first 7-8 years. Don't look at CTC too much, but look at what capability are you bringing which will distinct yourself differently. I think this is the key, because first 7-8 years, when you are not at sitting at the top, is a time when you can dirty your hand in everything. And once you have built that skill sets, then you are able to run the race faster. And to my mind, just like in a marathon, the last leg you find those people who win the race actually run the fastest. So for a career point of view, I would believe last 15 years or 18 years or 17 years of your career, you should be able to run the fastest, and you should be able to run the fastest at the top. Running at the top is difficult because there are 5-6 more who may run faster than you, and therefore you can run faster and stay there only if you have built capabilities in the initial years. There are a lot of people I see today in corporate who change jobs, hop jobs, get fancy designations, get fancy salaries, but capability wise they are not there. So that's the point I want to leave with all of you today, that look at building capabilities. I think it's very, very important. Because also remember one thing, whatever you earn in the first 25 years of your service, you earn the double of it in the last 15 years of your service. So, you know, you must know where your gratuity and PF will come from. Because today, what I keep saying, last 15 years of your job, you have to earn, presuming that the life expectancy will further increase with healthcare improvement which is happening. So if you have to live in this world for 75-80 years, actually last 15 years you have to earn for 30 years of livelihood. You have to keep that in mind. You cannot be a burnt out at 40 running at 100 meter race. So look at adding value to yourself. This is my humble submission to all of you sitting here. I am speaking out of my experience. Maybe your experience will be different. You will be speaking something else from this stage. But this is what I have kind of learned, that this is the reality on the ground. So employment is no longer viewed as a lifelong commitment. Rather, it's a performance contract that is continually renewed. Something which I was trying to tell you, that not necessarily, because I have seen, and I'm seeing it every day, irrespective from which B school the person has passed, when the downturn comes, you look at in telecom what has happened recently, you look at in automobile what is happening. People from premium institutes are just getting laid off. Not that they are not good, but that they are not good enough to be retaining the payroll when somebody, when the organization has to take a call who should be on the board and who should not be on the board. Employees are being asked to do more and do it differently and share in the organization. I think this is very, very important, because see, today what we are finding also, people, I was talking to one of your dean just now, in some function what typically happens in R&D, also in academics, I can share this, because I was heading this management development here in Tata Steel before I left Tata Steel some 5-6 years back. You know, I used to see all my faculty, they never used to share what they are making a presentation. They will all keep it close to their heart. All case studies, all PPTs, nothing. And in some function it is okay, because we find it is an intellectual property. But organization at large gains only when people who are knowledgeable start sharing things in the organization, because then the organization becomes that much more rich. What we have seen and experienced in industry is that people who are good, they keep their knowledges to themselves and try and make themselves indispensable. The more somebody is doing that, the more he is not building his team. That point I will touch slightly later in the talk. And therefore it is important to build your team. Why, I will come slightly later into my presentation. So today we are talking about is that the new reward program must reinforce both individual competencies and performance and progress of the team. You know, for people in HR sitting in this hall, organizations are moving away from rewarding individual excellence. Because what has happened in India, earlier pre-1991, the difference in terms of rewards were not very high. There were no variable pay in those days. So increment was the steady state affair. A difference between a very high performer and a very low or average performer, the gap was not very high. Post 1991, we started hiring a lot of ideas from the West, and including hire and fire rule, and rewarding individual excellence. Now, once you are starting doing that too much, what happens is, in a team, if you look at it, the HR must come up with policy which corroborates collaborating behavior rather than competing behavior. So if my compensation is triggering something to do individual excellence high at the cost of team, then there is no teamwork in the organization can happen. So today in the organization we are looking at it, how do we reward people not only for his performance but also giving sufficient weightage to the team performance. And if you look at Japan, even today the best of the companies, they don't differentiate very much between the high performers and not very high performers. If you look at 15-20 years, the gap would be very less. India, in between US and Japan somewhere, we have gone for a mixed economy. But I think what suits us more is what Japan is doing. Take processes up, take capabilities of people up and stand right there, rather than rewarding individuals. The team doesn't gain in that process. Top 10 organization challenges, if you look at in today's context, one is sustain the steady top line growth. Each organization wants to do it. Last year, year and a half, organizations are struggling to do it. We have been seeing results of many players who are not able to achieve the top line growth. Speed, flexibility, adaptation to change, I think, has become a DNA to organization today. Customer loyalty and retention, I think, is becoming a key subject. Because in this economy, everybody is fighting for the customer share, and it can happen only if you have a very strong customer touchpoint program in your organization. if you don't have it, the first line customer, it's not going to happen. And what I would say is, you know, manufacturing organization in India has not done this very well still. But the service industry, to my mind, has done this piece exceedingly well. And I'll give you an example why I'm saying so. You know, if you check into any of the good hotels, you know, somebody who pick up your bag is maybe on a third party payroll. Somebody who does your registration is a bottom of the pyramid clerk, the lady who, you know, check you in your hotel. Somebody who makes your bed or clean your toilet are not on their payroll. Even when you go to the restaurant, you know, people who are helping you is again bottom of the pyramid. And when you are given the feedback form, I think 9 out of 10 times we give excellent rating. Never I have at least met a general manager or a managing director or a vice president of any good hotels ever. And most of the time I have given excellent rating because they have standardized behaviors. They have standardized what customer wants and how they can, how we can delight them. I think manufacturing as an organization, to my mind, has to learn a lot still from them, because there's still a lot of arrogance. If the product complaint comes, even from the OEMs, a lot of company does, even including Dynasty when I was here, we used to send the departmental head. Till the point we understood, let us send the associate who is making the coil to supply to Hyundai for car manufacturing to understand his passing, how it has created problem in the plant. So that, you know, the bottom of the pyramid try to understand the customer interface. So I think this is a very important piece in today's time, and no organization can take liberty of undermining the customer loyalty and retention. It's very, very key to business. Innovation, creativeness, I think. See, innovation is something which I want to say again. There was a time when industry would say that we are doing innovation. Today it's necessary, because the world is just moving like this. If you don't innovate, it's not for you to innovate to be ahead of time, but innovation for you is more important to stay with time. Actually, it's gone like that. You take any industry and look at, if you look at products, what it was last year and what it is today, things have changed, you know, and therefore one has to do it faster than what the competition somewhere is doing. Managing costs, I talked about. Retention of talent, I think, is becoming extremely key to organization. And why it is key, you know, as an HR person, something which I experience every day, and some of you who have taken HR as a discipline, you will face it tomorrow. The problem is that whosoever, the talent pool which walks into your organization, actually walks into your organization with an offer letter already, not one, maybe two or three, which offers them better salary, which offer them better designation, which offer them better place of posting, and yet you have to satisfy him that this company is still the best place for you. It's not an easy job because people have choices today. So the HR in the organization, to my mind, if they are able to build a very strong people-centric culture, I think the retainability happens. And what our experience has proved that CTC doesn't retain people. In fact, there was a time when telecom was paying the highest CTC, and yet it was sitting at a 35-40% attrition rate. So it doesn't actually retain you. What retain people is the, you know, culture and the people orientation in the organization. I think from Excite, we as an organization, I'm not marketing my company, but I'm saying we focus this a lot. To an extent, when I moved from Tata Steel there, I was surprised to see their culture, that somebody who's posted in Bangalore plant has ailing parents in Calcutta, and the guy wants to come to help the parent. The management guideline is as clear as this. First thing is transfer him immediately to Calcutta, let him take care of his parents. Organization, we have more people, we will fill up the job. If you don't have enough people, then possibly we have not done enough to have the talent pipeline in the organization. Priority goes first to the employee, and after he's taken care of his ailing parent or whatever it is, then the company transfers them back. I see even policy like this stitches people in company for lifetime. It's not big thing which you do, but I think something which touches your heart is something which makes people, you know, keep wedded to the organization. Because today, you know, there was a time, I know, when I started my career, we used to go to the campus and we used to sell career proposition to freshers that how you take your life with us in Tata Steel. You know, you join and you retire. Today nobody joins to retire a company. That's what has happened in reality. But still organizations are working hard to get back that mindset that we can still do all that for you. Pan-India global workforce, I think, is something organizations, each organization is looking in for. Succession planning is becoming very, very key. Again, from the point of view of disruptive practices which is happening in the market. Expansion and growth is also very key. You know, what is just a minute on this. If I look at some 3 years, 4 years back to the way India economy was being predicted, a lot of people on the Excel sheet said, if this is the way GDP is going, this much job will be created, this much opportunity will get. A lot of capex were cleared. People started investing and we saw a dip in the GDP. Today we see those companies are going bankrupt and they're not able to do whatever they have to do. So they have to sell off the core processes just to sustain the main organization. So I think one has to be very clear. It's not an Excel sheet exercise. One need to really have a vision to understand what's going to happen and then put things in place. And many a time if you are late in expanding and when the competition is doing faster than you, then also you lose market share. So it's a very fine edge sword, which I think we come with experience, but I think not very many people are there in the corporate to actually handle it with that expertise. I think I've spoken on the last piece. So change, I think, is something which is there. We talk about. And here, you know, on the change part, I would say technology, I would put customer needs I have already stressed about. Technology is another thing which is driving the lifestyle of us. Workforce demographics. I think we need to understand how the workforce is changing. It's changing at such rapid speed. And Pradeep was there in an HRD presentation. I see it happening obviously in the management cadre much with a very high phenomenal rate. But I am finding today, for those of you who would be specializing in HR or some of you who are going to the plant, that Gen Y workforce blue collars are changing with the equal rapid speed. Today, when I talk to the union or talk to the youngsters who are walking to the organization, they are also on WhatsApp, they are also on Facebook, they also go to the same shopping mall, they also go to the same multiplexes, they also expect a visiting card they should have, not only management card they should have. And I think it's radical change which is happening. So organization need to understand, and why I'm trying to say, just I think I made that mention last time, but I would like to repeat, you know, we have a tie-up with Japan for our technology tie-up, and I was in one of my plant where one of my workers told me that I need a visiting card. You know, it came as a shock to me as to why he's asking for a visiting card. I said, why do you want a visiting card? So, sir, so I thought he would say that since we have, you should have, he didn't answer anything. He said, look, we are taking technology from Shinkobe of Japan, and they, when their workers come to us, they give the, us our visiting card. And today, my technology is at par with what Japan has implemented because we have taken the same technology. So I am working with the same machine. I am doing more production because Japan market is not that big, our market is much. So I am doing more production, I am doing with the same machine. When he asked for a visiting card, I have to write on a paper and give. So would you not consider? Actually, it came to me as a shock that this is how distant we are still and we don't understand what is happening at the ground level. You know, we have a system that we have a uniform in the plant and we say 5 days you can be on uniform, 6 days you can be on casual, be it jeans, t-shirt, whatever you can come in. But we have not made the similar change for the work plan. We said all 6 days we have to come on uniform. So this guy asked me that why should I not come in the uniform, in the casual on Saturday when your officers are coming. I don't have an answer. I said, yes, please come. Now it's not only happening with the permanent employees. If you look at the people who are coming on contract, if you look at it, most of the organization in India, they have a uniform which is different for permanent employee. There's a uniform which is different for a contract employee. Maybe the cloth is same, quality is same, fine, colors are different, just to differentiate. And again, one of the contract employee asked me, why do you want to differentiate? Why can't I have the same color of uniform which your people are? Because I am also working for you. Now, what we used to talk, white collar, blue collar, all is going away. And if we can understand this faster, then we are forced to understand maybe a lot of Maruti episode will get avoided. You know, that's what is happening at that time. So I'm not touching each of the points because I policies, as I said, has to be contemporary with time. You know, if somebody is sick, you have to take care of it. You can't say, let your parents go to hell, this is the job, you do it. It doesn't work. The guy may leave you. I think this is something which all of you would have read it, so I don't want to get into it. Maybe somebody in my HR has put this like that. So change model, I wanted to talk one thing out of my experience. I don't know whether this is a model or not, but it's purely something which I have put up based on my experience. You know, any change starts with denial. You know, I think all of you will agree on this. Then come resistance that no, I don't want to do it. And then come a stage where people start exploring, yes, okay, let's look at it. And then come a time when people accept change. Do you think the change has happened if somebody from denial to acceptance has gone? What is the next thing which should come?
Implement.
Okay. How will implement come? I have accepted it. I am a smoker. How many of you smoke? Good. Even I smoke. I know that smoking is not good for health. I accept it. I go up to this level. What is that I need to do? This is what happens in organization. Actually, the next word I have put is commitment to change. I don't commit myself to stop quitting smoking. In organization also, when organization talks about change, people move from denial to acceptance very fast. But this journey is absolutely a big Herculean task for each one of us. And so in a meeting we say, yes, it needs to be done. But then that's all in the meeting. It doesn't happen. In real life also something is what happens. So I think my thought process is change doesn't happen unless people commit with behaviors to that change. I think that is very important. I think irrespective of the function you will go tomorrow, look for commitment of people to change. Don't look at acceptance of people for change. I think there is a subtle difference between the two. You know, even a relationship, people say, okay, I accept you as a boyfriend or a girlfriend, but I don't commit for getting married or something like that. In my batch, all of them accepted, none of them got married. I don't know. So I think this is the process. Then another thing, you know, if you look at some of these names, Mother Teresa, Gandhi, Mandela, Mathur, so, you know, change doesn't have to start from the top. You know, if you look at each of these names, I know none of them had the executive power of being a prime minister or a president of the country, but each one of them have put up a disruptive history, and what actually worked was passion, not power. So I think we need to understand, it's not the power which changes things, but it is the passion which kinds of drive things. And in organization also, you know, many a time we say, it's top who decides. I don't think so tops ever decide. If somebody is passionate enough, irrespective of the level, I think he can make the change. I'll just give you a Cadbury experience because I was talking to their HR head some years back here in this hall, we have called him. You know, there was a time when Cadbury had come with a problem, there were some flies inside, you know. I don't know if some of you would have recalled that time. And Cadbury market has dipped dramatically. And they were brainstorming what we need to do to quickly get back the market share up. And when they were having brainstorming session, and I recollect he said, a sales officer from Ghaziabad region said in that meeting, while other high-flying idea was going on in the boardroom discussion, this guy said, so there's one person in India, if he says, everybody listens. And that person is Mr. Amitabh Bachchan. So if he verifies that I have seen the plan and everything is right, people will believe him. And that's the ad which came, and they came back to the market share very fast. So what I'm saying is, it was not the managing director of the company or the board which decided whom to engage. And that's what happens in real life. Now this is something which is very close to my heart. You know, I have seen organization and I have seen managers. They try and over-manage things, but actually they under-led the team. So over-manage, under-led is a syndrome. And even today in your life or tomorrow when you start up job, look at your engagement pad somewhere. You know, out of 8 hours, out of 10 hours, how much of time you are using to manage and how much of time you are putting to lead the team. I think the more on leading is what we should do. But problem is, most of the time we try to manage things ourselves. And I keep asking people, why I'm saying is, when we look at promotions which happen in the organization from one level to another, I see the person who are doing five jobs, he get promoted, designation changes, CTC changes, he get a bigger car. But look what he's doing 8 hours, he's still doing 90% of what he was doing in a level below. Because he's still holding on to everything. And so what he's doing, he's trying to overmanage thing. And somebody who has to do a thing at his level is not able to do because boss wants to do everything. So overmanage, underlead is a huge problem in organization. And something which I keep saying out of my experience is, each time you move up in the leadership hierarchy, try and let go at least 3-4 things which you are doing earlier to the people who are reporting into you. And try and acquire doing 3 or 4 new things which you are not doing earlier. So let go and acquire new. If you continuously do, you are going to add value to yourself and you are going to add value to the organization. But people generally don't do it. They still hold on a few things where they are comfortable with. I have seen people in organization moving from finance to MD. He is a managing director, but even 70% of time still on finance. Because he is not comfortable with the plant or with the market. I have seen people from marketing becoming managing director, more comfortable with marketing people rather than with operation in other space. So, you know, we can't carry this baggage too long. You know, one need to drop it. I don't see that happening with a lot of people. And therefore, this is something which I think is extremely important in the leadership space. And therefore, what happens in organization is, you know, when you try and overmanage, we say people are useless. The other guy whom we are saying he is useless, he says that I am useless, not useless. So you are not using me, otherwise I can deliver you. And you are not unleashing the potential of or the capability of the person who are reporting into you, because you are still into the syndrome of managing things for yourself. And therefore when these people go to other jobs or other organizations, they start delivering far better. So what is leadership? I think some of these questions, the real sign of leadership are amongst the followers. Are they reaching their potential, your followers who are reporting to you? Are they reaching their potential? Are they learning, you know, are they achieving desired results and so on and so forth? So one need to look at some of these questions to see whether you are leading your team or you are not leading your team. Where the leadership power comes from? Either it comes from the knowledge base, which is expert power, knowledge on the core subject. It comes with the legitimate power of your position. And but you know, or it comes from your power of rewarding or punishing somebody, or it comes from referent power. To my mind, the last one is the most important. I have seen leadership is not about, see, I keep talking about it, that you know, when organization actually, I'll give you my own example. When I moved, don't take it, I am praising myself, but I'm just trying to bring a point home. When I was put as a director on the board of the company, in Excite 70 years of existence, I am the first HR person who has gone on the board. I am the first HR person who the business is reporting. So board appointed me. And I was thinking to myself, have I really become a director on board? And the answer which came to me resounding was a big no. Because circular issuing doesn't mean that you have become a director. You have to walk that much of mile where people start accepting you as a director, that yes, they see, yes, this guy can add value and this guy can add value. So you have to earn yourself to that position. Many a time I have seen an organization, people are promoted, but they don't put any effort on their own part to earn that position. And if that doesn't happen, the chair becomes more heavier to these people. So the issue is, are you more heavy than the chair, or the chair is more heavy on you, is the call which somewhere we have to take. And therefore, what kind of capability you need to build in is extremely important. And this, I think, comes more with reference to power only, that how much you do it yourself. And please remember one thing which I think linked to this, because most of you I know is going to grow very fast in corporate, and I think this is the point I wanted to kind of share with all of you with my own experience. You know, the chances are that very soon in the corporate life, for most of you, you will have people reporting into you who would be senior in age than you, who would be higher in qualification at times with you, who could be a better potential than you, but maybe organization has put you at a higher pedestal. It can happen with most of you. It has happened with me as well. Now, what happens when you are given that position and there are people who are reporting to you who are senior with equivalent qualification or better qualification? Do you think they will accept you day one? Who should take initiative for getting accepted? Absolutely. So, you know, what people need when you grow that fast up, I have learned one thing. People want to be respected. They are not envious of the fact that you have gone up. But if you respect to them, of their experience, of their background, I think they will buy in with you. There was a time, I remember, in this organization, when I was transferred to this role as head of management development, I had people who were 10 years, 15 years elder to me, who were from XLRI and IIM's combination, and they were much superior to me in any way, but somehow management put me here. I have never called them in my office in the first 3 months. Whenever I used to have a work, I used to call Mr. Verma, I need to talk to you. And I have never called him Verma or something like that. I have to give him with that name and respect of age, walk into his room and speak. I did this for 3 months, and the fourth one onward, they would say, "Nay, nay, we are coming to your room and speaking." So it's not the first power, you know, your legitimate power which you use, but I think it is the next power which you have to earn is very important. And I think all of you will get into that very fast. But please remember by this word that the humility of yours of reaching out to people will have a higher buy-in. And why I am saying is this, I think maybe somewhere next slide is this, so I am not talking that point. On team I will speak something, why I want to deal this subject this way. Okay, these are the issues on transformational leadership and transactional leadership. I am not getting into this PPT, but I think the next slide I will teach you about all this. So creating vision and all that, I am just skipping these slides. Then what typically is done on leadership, what is management, I think Excel curriculum will definitely take care of this, the very basics too. But what I want to talk to you is, I think this is where I want to come to. See, if you ask me what is leadership, how do you define a leader, any one of you? What is a leader?
A leader is someone who walks the talk, inspires others in the team, as well as brings out the best in them as well.
Absolutely. See, you know, there was a time when the leaders, we thought, means that they should have followers. If you don't have a follower, there was a definition, I remember when we used to study, that if you don't have a follower, you're not a leader. You can't be a leader of yourself. So you have to have followers. That was the concept at some point in time of leadership. Also, the concept which exists is if you're a leader, you have to have a subordinate. Today, I think good organizations are not using the word subordinate because I think it's not the right thing to do. I think the role of a leader in any organization, to my mind, is to create more leaders in the team. And that's the reason I'm saying that humility of unleashing the potential of your team is becoming very, very important. Because please understand, in a competitive world like this, where the shelf life of products and services are perishing at a dramatic pace, you can exist and survive only if you are able to build more leaders under you. And therefore, the more you invest in people to make them good leaders, your job becomes easier. See, when you start a career, maybe your contribution will decide how you will grow, initial stages. But you know, I know, passing out from these kind of institute, you will move to a level very soon where you will have a team to work with, right? And when you have a team to work with, then your performance appraisal will not be decided by what you are able to deliver, but what you as a team is able to deliver. So, you know, a good teamwork is not about having a people of five who are delivering five people output, but having a team of five who are delivering seven, eight people output. I think that's the way the organization would like to look at it. So, building leaders in your group will become absolutely essential. And how do you unleash that is something which you have to do it. And that will come with only if you have innate in you, irrespective of the function you are, that you have to have humility, you have to be approachable to people, you have to have the human touch. All that is very, very important. Challenge of leadership is to bring out, again, the wealth of talent, employee process, I think something which he said, and need to understood. And true leader must be generate. I think this last point of great coaches is very important. See, you know, time has come today when there are two thoughts which I want to share with you. You know, does designation has unleash potential or it restrict unleashing potential? It's actually restrict more. See, what happens is if I tell you you are manager HR, you are general manager HR, you are general marketing, you may have capability when you leave the place of work, you go home, you can manage your finance, you manage your HR at home, you manage your marketing at home, you manage your you are a good coach to your children to grow up and give them career, right? You are a good counselor to your wife if you are good. So I am saying there are so many things which you do out, but once you walk into the organization, you start wearing a cap very fast the moment you punch your card that okay, now for the next 8 hours, 10 hours, I am an HR manager, a marketing manager, a finance manager, so I know only this, I don't know anything else. So A, designation limits your capability to a large extent. B, hierarchy to my mind also limits a lot of unleashing capability in the organization, because what happens in true sense is, and this has been proven by data with a lot of studies being done, that not necessarily a leader in an organization is the best out of the team which is reporting to him. What happens is, simply because I was good and I had more years of experience, I am sitting on a chair of power, but there could be a person in your team who could be more in capability than you, and given a chance he can deliver much more than what you can deliver, but he is just not there, right? So the issue is, if the organization is too hierarchical and the management start looking talent pool like that, then what happens is the visibility of talent pool also get reduced dramatically. And today large organizations are suffering from the fact that they don't have the visibility of the talent pool which is there in the organization. They are able to see, you know, as the iceberg theory, top of the pool. Getting down into the talent pool is becoming a huge issue, and I think therefore the leaders to take a role of a mentor and coach is becoming extremely important. I think in any organization, if you look at competency profile of any organization, the three things comes: either you manage yourself, or you manage processes, or you manage other. There are three things. All your assessment center, development center, whatever you call it, people are actually judged on these three parameters. I just put in what would it mean in terms of looking at the organization from the leadership standpoint of view. But I think the processes are this. So it's very important to manage self better. It's important to manage processes extremely well. It's also important to manage people irrespective of whether it's superior or subordinate or whatever it is. I think somehow or the other I have kind of touched this issue. Second point I think I have touched, encouraging the heart. I think today organizations are going back from the mercenary way of looking at people to looking at this. I think there are organizations now who in downturn don't, you know, lay off their people first, they carry their people and wait for the right time to come. So I think a lot of heart is going now into how do you deal with the talent. Because see, somebody, in some way, when the organization says that the human assets is my asset, you know, human talent is my asset, overnight they cannot become liability simply because the market has gone down. So what do you do with your asset in uptime and downtime? And also, so a lot of work is happening here in this space. I think this I have said, but again for repetition, you know, both should enhance one another. I think this is where I am talking about. Followers may be a potential leader, I think I already spoken about. It's not a time today that, you know, you can say, I just tell you one example. You know, the leader said that, okay, there was one guy in my company who said that if you have any problem, try and resolve yourself. And don't come with a problem to me. Come with a solution. So if you have a problem, don't look up. Look within and come with a solution. I think he practiced this in his department. And we saw number of people, who would engage with the superior. If you look at a transaction analysis on a parent to child mode, actually the more of discussion started happening more in A to A level, where the person will go with options and solution, and also the superior will, engage him at the adult level. So organizations are more moving, irrespective of the fact the person is junior or senior, 1 year experience, 10 years, it doesn't matter. End of the day, it's all collaborative. Because a brilliant idea can come from anywhere. It need not necessarily, many a time I always say experience can be a huge baggage to all of us. I think I'm coming to one of the last few slides I have. Future leadership needs. I think, I don't know how much you will be able to grasp this point, but the point I'm trying to drive home is, today when we look at organization, or when I look at my organization and my talent pool, one way of looking at it is, how do I look at my talent pool and my organization with respect to today's market, or a market which is emanating in a year or two, which is a very short-term way of looking talent pool. I think today time has come, largely for the HR fraternity, I would say, that irrespective of the organization you go, you start envisioning where does this organization will be 10 years, 8 years from now, to the extent you can envision by talking to the line manager, understanding the market, taking your hand, and then seeing what kind of capability, if it is not there in the organization, we need to bring in. Because if you don't do this exercise, many a time it becomes too late. I'll give you an example. We were recruiting some R&D chief for our company, and today, in the battery space, huge changes are happening with electric cars coming into it, hybrid cars coming into it, lithium ion coming into so many space. So we were looking at a talent, and typically what has happened is, the chief of R&D of my company sent me a JD, which was almost a photostat copy of what he was doing. And he said, this is what I think we need. And then I called him and I sat with him and said, how do you think your role will change the next 3 years? So he made something different. So I said, this is still the same, not much change. But then I told him, these kind of things, I'm reading the paper. Do you think some of these things will happen? He said, yes, but maybe 7-8 years down the road. I said, fine, even if you're saying 7-8 years down the road, should I not look at a talent now who should have capability of next 3 years and also next 8 years? Because if you don't bring such talent pool in your organization ahead of time, it could be too late in an organization. Because I think, as I said, the product is perishing very fast, that's what is happening. So you may become out of business very fast. So I think this is more for HR to look at from that point of view. Thank you. So if there are any questions, I think I can address.
Sir, you rightly mentioned that every one of us has hidden capabilities in us, and organizations these days are appreciating that. And you have realized in your experience that even though people come from premier colleges, there are people who are even at the bottom of the pyramid who have the solutions, and they're not in marketing, but they are able to address the problems which are in marketing. Now my question is, even today when people who are from one function, they try and apply for some other function, there is a resistance in organizations to actually appreciate those people. They just reject them and they're looking for expertise. Is that changing in your perception in the HR world now?
What you're saying was largely true some years back, I would say.
but it's not audible. I'll go there. See, what you're saying, looking at
talent pool, more with respect to, see, if somebody is from HR, he has to be lifetime in HR. Somebody is in marketing, he has to be lifetime in marketing. Or somebody is an engineer in plant, he has to be lifetime in plant. To an extent that if some engineer is joining automobile, he can't move to power industry or he can't move to, you know, some other sectors. They're wedded to only that sector. Now, that's the way I think talent has been seen in this country. But now, what is happening is, I will give example of all the three organizations I have worked. If I look at Balapur Industry when I was there, or Tata Steel, or even Exide. You know, what we are talking about as a process is, first 5 years, 10 years, you need to build your functional capability from which function you have come. That is very, very, very key. Because if you don't have expertise on a function where you have come from, acquiring other skill sets from acceptance and buying could be an issue. After 7 years or 8 years of experience in your core function, today, organizations through their development workshop or talent management exercises they have, they are identifying talents who have a flair to move from a function A to function B. That's one part of it. Second is, a lot of companies today have mandated actually that if you have to become a divisional head or a functional head or a CEO of a company, the formulas are three rotation, three functions. Otherwise you can't go up. HR guy, if he has to become a business head, he has to move into marketing, he has to move into finance for some time, and then only possibly he can think himself moving at a CEO role. Otherwise, what will happen is, as I gave you an example in my talk, is somebody who has spent his lifetime in finance and you move him as CEO, at best he will be a finance chief only. And he will only look the industry from EBITDA margin and top line, bottom line growth. He will miss possibly a larger picture of getting more market share. How do you innovate more product to get into the market? No, because it is not innate in him. He has not been rotated or groomed that way. So I think today organizations are definitely looking at talent pool who can move from one function to the other. And that is precisely the reason why today, if company goes and pay high CTCs for people to be picked up from B schools, is not to make you live in this function for lifetime. But again, as I said, if you are not investing in yourself and expecting the organization should rotate, you may or may not happen. So it also depends what you are doing to yourself in terms of acquiring that skill sets to be rotated or to be seen and visible in the organization, that yes, if this guy can be given a function in HR, though he's in a plant guy, can still do a good job. So I think a lot depends on us, what kind of behaviors we start demonstrating in the organization, having had some acceptability. I always say, you know, in an organization, a talent can be seen at a three level. One is, yes, I know that talent. Means you are discussing a problem, okay, give it to Anurag, he will do it. So there is a brand a person has created for himself. The other category of people is, there's a problem. Yeah, if you give it to Sanjay, he may or may not be able to do. You can take a chance, so we are not sure. Still not bad. The third category is, no, this problem, how about giving to Naveen? Naveen, I don't know about him. This is dangerous. And it happens in organization, irrespective of the background, that people have not, the Johari window, if you have read, I don't know, you have kept your Johari window so small, so unopened, the organization doesn't know your capability. So they are not able to decide for you, which is extremely bad. It's good for organization to say he is good, he is bad. But what I am saying is, you also, as an individual, need to create a brand in your organization. And something which I keep saying, not only for marketing people, for irrespective of discipline we come from, we need to market ourselves. And don't undermine my this statement. In a large organization, chances are you will be invisible, you will be lost. But it is you who will do things differently and market yourself differently, whereby you become visible to the organization. So how you make yourself visible is important. I have said that in my presentation, that you have to be seen distinct in the group. If you do that, it is going to happen. That's the way it is. You know, why I'm saying, in this company when I joined, moving from steel, ISU, and we had lead smelting units. So I knew every process. in meeting I used to speak more than the CEO of the company. And then the managing director of the company felt that possibly he can take charge of this function as well. I'm not an engineer, but engineers do report it to me. But it's something possibly I have demonstrated whereby the management thought that yes, possibly he can do this. So I think a lot of depend on us also. It's a two-way process.
So we have second question.
I'll speak.
So I've got a follow-up question.
Yeah.
Pretty similar actually. So you spoke about what happens with people who are into an organization. I've been with an organization for a few years, then I change my function. Now the stage at which we are, like we have got minimum 5 years of experience. We do our MBA here. Now say my case, I mean, I come from a typical IT background, right? Done software development all my life. Say I want to move to a marketing function. But then when an organization comes in, what typically happens, what you're facing is, you are from an IT background, so we do not know whether you can do marketing at all. So the problem arises wherein, if I'm in an organization somewhere down the line, I change, that's happening. But then when I'm getting into an organization typically look at what I've done in the past, and can I do that in the future? So that's where the concern is. Are organizations nowadays willing to look at your potential beyond what you've done in the past?
See, you know, are you in the executive MBA course?
Yes.
Okay. You see, what happens is, because we have picked up also from executive MBA course from this institute, Accelerate, also a couple of years back. Now, when we are picking a executive MBA student, I don't think so we look at what background you are coming from. Because if you wanted to be in that space for your lifetime, possibly you don't have opted to do a 1 year course at Accelerate. Right? I think more progressive organizations understand that very clearly. Because you are looking for a career change. It's the reason why you are doing this course. If you are too passionate and wedded to your background, then fine, you can say, no, I want only IT job. Or I want only marketing job. But yes, you can branch out. I'll tell you recently, this time, where was it? Because there's so many campus I'm doing, I'm forgetting which campus I was. I have taken a B.Tech, M.Tech in IT in the HR job. That guy had a fantastic flavor on HR. I can go on record, in the last 3 years I have taken people, I have yet to come across a person who was so clear on people issue. He was IT, B.Tech, M.Tech, I have taken in HR. And I asked him, he says, yes sir, I always wanted to do, but I don't know whether the company would have considered me. He was doing dual specialized marketing in HR. But I have taken him in HR, he's joining us. So I think this also depends what you demonstrate in the interview. So organization definitely would not look into, if I am going at an engineering college, the first level, if you are IT, I will look for IT, definitely. But otherwise, no. Executive MBA. See, all these things which is happening, executive MBA programs or XLIB school, is typically where you are trying to create business manager. Right? Some definitely a functional expert. A guy is too good in HR or too good in marketing, don't spoil him as a bad general manager. But somebody with a flavor to handle business, let him give that. I think that's the way it is.
Yeah. Good morning, sir.
Yeah.
I do believe the way you are saying that people, everybody should have some kind of expertise, as well as he or she should have some kind of perspective about everything going around. Okay. Regarding that, I think apart from people, a company or an industry should also have some kind of core competency that we hear day in and day out. Okay, so regarding that, I wanted to ask you, in Exide, we hear mostly about Exide working into automotive sectors and all, but in laptop market or laptop industry, I have never heard about Exide in the dry battery market. So can we expect Exide to enter into this market in a big way? Maybe I'm a bit ignorant about this market, but maybe that's my colleague.
You know, if you look at it, Exide is into a lead acid battery business. And lead acid business has stayed in this world for 150 years. And we believe that lead acid business, or market for lead acid battery, will still be there for the next 20-25 years, definitely. Because there are yet an alternative to come at that price point, which can trigger the volume, say with the kind of safety this provides. Now coming to lithium ion, we know that yes, lithium ion is something which can be a future. We are using it in a cell phone, we are using it in a laptop battery. In vehicular segment, it has a problem of getting explored. You have seen in the airlines, which airline is US has come up with the airline, it was it was grounded largely because of that reason. But just to give you a flavor, in India, the only electric car which is being produced is by Mahindra, the Reva. And we are supplying lithium-ion battery to them. So we are there. The only issue is that India as a market has not picked up that volume. Now to set up a capacity for such production, I don't think so. The market is ready today. Even the cost-wise, there are issues. And please understand, there is no infrastructure for this today. If you look at it, unlike in some of the first world countries where the electric cars are selling some decent number, not very good number, they are very good fast charging stations. You, India still have petrol pumps, you don't have fast charging stations. And so, depending on where you want to sell the car, now Mahindra wants to sell the car in metros, I don't think so that is the correct thought process on their part, because in metro people travel more than 150 kilometers. I think the best market for Reva would be place like Jamshedpur or Ranchi, where 100 kilometers a day you are done and you have fast charging stations. So I think let this market mature. We have a plan for lithium ion as well.
Once again, because of positive time, this will be the last question. Thanks.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
As you said, you are the market leader in this in your segment and category. For the last 5 years, what are the marketing measures you have taken to increase the overall size of the market?
See, you know, this company came into existence last 68 years back. And for the last 68 years, I think I can say with a lot of pride that this is one of the company which has been the last market leader for the all last 68 years and has made profit every year, has given dividend every year. And the next competition is less than half our size, which is Amaron battery, and that too is only in automotive, not as much in industrial application, because we operate out of two SBU. One is automotive, which kind of deal with moped battery to large batteries. We are the only one in the country to make submarine batteries, you know, so all the Navy submarines runs out of our batteries. Then we have another SBU which is industrial, which make traction batteries. Batteries for telecom application, for tower, for inverters battery, UPS battery, you know, so there's a huge market. There's a lot of technical battery, railways battery, so many of them we make. What we have seen in the last 5-6 years is, you all are aware, there has been a mushroom growth of vehicle in the country. And sitting at a 80-90% market share, in some cases we are sitting at a 100% market share. The replacement market comes every 3 years. And we make money actually on replacement market. So while the automobiles are not selling as many numbers, but if I look at the number of cars which was sold 3 years back was huge, and therefore we are still making money because that's where the money is. And this market has grown. And if India, I would say it would not be right to compare India with China, because China is far ahead, but you know, by habit we say India, China. If you go to China and then you see where they were. But I think even if India has to become half of China in the next 5 years or 7 years, there's a huge potential of growth. So while we operate as of now out of 12 factories, maybe we are looking ahead to setting up a mega factory again, just to see that when the growth gets triggered, we are not short in supply or battery. Because please remember one thing, that if you don't have a capacity, the competition will take over the market. And it's very difficult to get back that market. So I think we're keeping an eye on that also. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such an insightful session. I would now request our esteemed faculty to come over and present a token of remembrance to our guest of honor today. Professor Indrajit Mukherjee to present the program of the morning. So I would now request Pradeep to come over and deliver the vote of thanks.
So first of all, on behalf of XLRI's 1 year general management program, I would like to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule and coming to our campus. It's been a pleasure to have you here in our campus. Also about the session, thank you for this wonderful session. Messages like making a difference, change model, letting go and acquiring new are embedded in us now. You have sown the seeds of transformational leadership in us. Hope it grows into a big tree and helps the society and organization at large. Thank you so much, sir. I would like to thank the students and faculties for coming forward and making this session a grand success. Last but not the least, thank you so much, leadership committee, for organizing this session and making it a grand success. Thank you so much.